Hello, dear chess friends. I have the pleasure to announce that we are starting a new project. We are going to produce some series concerning the chess psychology, something which is extremely important for every tournament player, every chess player in general. And unfortunately, this subject is not sufficiently well covered in the chess literature. I have the pleasure to present my guest today, the French psychotherapist, Richard Buono.
Hello.
He's a psychotherapist. He's also teaching psychology. One of his main domains of interest is the hypnosis. He's not only practicing it, but also he's teaching hypnosis for a very long time. He has a lot of experience in this domain. And also, he's very interested in the application of different psychological tools in the field of chess. And not only in the field of chess, but in sports in general, we can say. Of course, Richard is not someone who is external to chess because he has occupied the post of vice president of Monaco Chess Federation. Also, he is a chess aficionado. He's regularly playing and he's very well aware of all the issues that different chess players face. So I'm glad to welcome you, Richard. We are going to make a series of videos featuring the chess psychology. Why do you think psychology is so crucial in the field of chess, and how our concept of making such video series can contribute to the development of the chess players?
Well, thank you, Grigor, for this introduction and these questions. That is very important. I play for decades. I noticed that this is something really that there's a real lack of knowledge and understanding about what's going on really in the mind, but not specifically in the field of chess, but in the field of consciousness, memory, emotions, stress. And there has been a lot of, let's say, books and all kind of information about technical chess. Of course, we have books on openings, middle games, end games, and very few talk about psychology. There are very famous books that has been written so far, but very few. And of course, since there's a lot of discoveries, new things, new techniques, we can improve in a good proportion the potential of a chess player, like we do in many other sports like golf or tennis, whatever. You need a lot of concentration, and chess is like another sport. So psychology, it could be very helpful to understand the process of mind and the power of the mind and how to prevent the problems of the emotions and the stress.
Very well. Thank you for this throughout answer. And first of all, before we start, I want to say a few words about the format of our interview, because all the other series will follow the same logic. And that's why I find it necessary to present the general concept. In each one of our series on psychology, Richard is going to present one powerful tool which is designed to help chess players to manage the stress and to boost their performance. And of course, after discussing the theoretical aspects of this psychological tool, we will also take a look at some chess applications. And here is when I will interact with some examples that I will, of course, discuss with my dear guest. So for today, you have chosen a very interesting topic and one very interesting tool, which will be very powerful when it comes to improving the our performance in games and tournaments as well. Can you say a few words about it? What is the tool that you're going to present today?
Today, I choose to present something that is called dissociation. Of course, we could talk about it for a long time. We can make many lectures about it. So we will try to be very clear and precise on this description and what we can do with it. This is something that could be useful in all aspects of life, but we're going to see how it can be used within the perimeter of playing chess.
Very well. So it sounds really interesting. Okay, let's first of all explain the very concept of dissociation. What does it mean? What is the purpose of using this tool? Let's make one a short theoretical introduction, if you wish.
This is very simple. Dissociation is the contrary of association. Basically, when you are in your everyday's task in living, you try to think about what you do. You try to be associated, meaning that you are conscious of what you do and where you are, what you are doing, and every stimulation of your common senses. Dissociation is to change this reality. You change it in various ways, meaning that you're not anymore associated. You change your perspective from your mind or physically or in a mix of the two. This is commonly used as the way to protect yourself unconsciously. It exists a set in psychology of a defense mechanism, and dissociation is one of them. Basically, when you are under heavy stress or all of a sudden you can't handle a situation, you have this sudden, let's say, reflex to be dissociated. And this is something that is naturally provoked, or you can train how to use this as a powerful tool. It can be, of course, the result of a pathology, we have to say it, because some mental disease can be, unfortunately, provoked by the fact that you cannot control this process. And this happens in some psychosis and some other problems of that kind. But, of course, this is a completely different topic. But it was important to mention it, that everybody does that every day without knowing the process itself. And this can be, to an extent, something that for some people, unfortunately, could be a source of troubles.
Yeah. So indeed, it seems that this tool is very, very powerful. And as a chess player, I immediately start thinking on all the possible applications in the field of chess. As far as I understood from your presentation, a chess player can apply the idea of dissociation on many levels. For instance, after a bad move played during the game, something terrible that happened during the game, or after a painful loss, after an unsuccessful tournament, If you want, we can discuss separately all the different applications of the dissociation for a chess player.
Yes. To understand maybe better the process, it is easy to understand what is the difference between a human being and a machine and a computer. The computer doesn't have emotions. Human beings have. So we have to find a way to use the advantage of both at the end. We need to have the capability, the ability to calculate, to see the chessboard and to go into deeply the game, to find imbalances and variations and calculations, tactics and such. But the problem are the emotions, because there is a context, there is a background. You are in a tournament fighting to be the very first of the tournament, or you have lost the previous game and you have all this workload, you know, emotional workload. So the problem is that you would like to be another person. You would like to be a computer without having all these emotions. Sometimes emotions can be very useful and sometimes they can be a problem because they alterate your abilities. So this is where dissociations comes in handy and helps you to make some workarounds, how to be to get the best out of your abilities without the emotions alterating your abilities.
Very often when analyzing my games, I see that, for instance, I have missed some very easy tactical solution that I would immediately spot if I'm just solving an exercise. And by listening to your explanations, I can realize that the source of this mistake are the past events during the game and the way all the past events affected my emotions. Do you find this logical?
Yes, it is, because every past event got several components. When you think about the past, you think with your, let's say, the sense that is the most active in your case, because everybody has different, let's say, ability according to the sense. For instance, some are most stronger in visualization, some other for hearing the things, some others is smelling. And everybody doesn't have the same sensitivity. They're not sensitive the same way. So when you have a souvenir, there is several components. One is the main sense, let's say, capability. For instance, visualization, you have an image. And you have the emotions that are linked to this souvenir. So the purpose is that if the emotions is very positive, you use the souvenir to get the resources back. And if, on the other hand, it's a negative, you have to detach the emotion from the souvenir. It means that when we will remind, you will not have the emotions that is attached to it. And this is all the purpose of fighting against, let's say, some post-traumatic disease or issues from soldiers or for whatever things, you know. And in chess, it's exactly the same. When you lost a game, for instance, you have this emotion that is attached to the souvenir of the game lost against such an opponent that you don't like or whatever.
I see. Indeed, it sounds really interesting. And let's begin with a simple practical application. How, in your opinion, a chess player can detach himself from past events that happened during a game? For instance, at the beginning, he was under a lot of pressure. by his opponent. The game was going in a very difficult way, but all of a sudden his opponent makes a mistake and provides some chance. Of course, in order to spot such an opportunity, we should be able to look at the position with fresh eyes. Unfortunately, however, we're too influenced by the past events, by all the stress that we have lived until now, and how one can maximize his chances to spot such opportunities.
Before to answer to this question, I would like to make an assessment about the preparation of the player, because if the player knows he's not well prepared, it's going to be another game. It's going to be another problem. If the player knows that he has been too much partying the night before, if the player is, let's say, in a particular situation that is not favorable for playing in general, this could be a problem. But we're going to, let's say that the player is prepared, normal, and everything is normal. It's important because, you know, like in science, you have to define a proper perimeter. You cannot just go into it as a general thing without having some assessments. So the very important thing is, like you said, having fresh eyes. What is the difference? The difference is like I said earlier with the computer. The computer doesn't have any problems to analyze a position because it's algorithmics. This is mechanical thing, it's completely different. The human being is when he sees a position, he start to analyze it. There is a lot of variations in the emotions. If you see that you can win a game in a few moves, or you may lose a game, if you are in control, or if you are under the control of the opponent, because sometimes you know that you may lose if the opponent plays such moves, or you may have the total control of it, that any moves played by the opponents will be a winning game. So in general, this is important to think, what would you play if you would be just someone attending to the game without being playing the game. You would be someone just approaching the table and watching the chessboard and say, oh, at this table there is such potential in the position and there is such problems or such variations interesting. What would you play in this position? This is very interesting because when you are at the table sitting and you are the player, it would be certainly a different view from if you would be attending the game as a spectator and watching the chessboard. It's very easy when you are in front of your screen, in the computer, you watch online championship, you see the position, and you say, oh yeah, I would play this, I would play that. And of course, it's completely different from being the player and the competitor that is actually playing the game. So this is where dissociate comes in. How could I be this spectator, this attending person, and the player at the same time?
Yeah.
So there is a different perspective of a background. And this is where you have to use some tricks to become this spectator.
Let's now discuss a little bit all the tricks that will allow a chess player to become a spectator.
Okay, this is very interesting because without knowing specifically, the chess player is very well trained for dissociation. Why? Because the chess player, every move changes the reality. Why? Because it anticipates. It's a game of anticipating something. When you are watching your position, you move the pieces around the board. You imagine the queen is on this square. If it goes on this square, the opponent's knight will move on the other square, the pawn will be taken, and such and such. So you create new realities. So this is something a chess player knows very well how to do it. This is the power of visualization. And visualization is very important. It means that I can see something that is not real. And you do that all the time. The problem is that you superpose new images, and after a certain amount of images, the alteration is too important and you may lose track of what you're looking. But this is a bit something we may develop in another clip. But what I want to say is that you are already trained for that. And the main tool is using visualization. What you see is not specifically the reality. What you see with your inner vision. You see a piece that is on the board somewhere, but is not really there. But you see it there. Yeah, you do that all the time for the tactics and for every aspect of the game. So you can do the same with you. If you can do it for your pieces on the board, you could do the same with you as a player. For instance, if we talk about mental techniques, because you have the physical and you have the mental, we're going to talk about it in a minute. You can, when you close your eyes, imagine you're elsewhere. You can maybe imagine that you're standing up beside the board and not sitting in front of your opponent. You can detach very easily the perspective of what you have in front of you. And this is where basically it's a game changer, because you, from a different perspective, change also the emotion that is attached to it. Okay, when you open your eyes, you have your opponent in front of you, you have such emotion. But if you would be attending the game and standing up aside the chessboard, you would have another emotion. So what you try to get is reduce the emotional impact by changing your perspective. So there is two ways to do it. Either when you sit down and you're capable to alterate this reality voluntarily, you choose a scenario. The scenario would be, for instance, I am not the current player. I am a spectator and I decided to sit down at this chess table and watch this game. Or you may have saw the position reverse, for instance, because you walked around and you've been looking at your own position from the reverse side, you know, and you could memorize this perspective and reuse it later on, for instance, because you force a change of reality. And sometimes it makes you realize many things, because I don't know, you probably have made this experience of watching the ball from the other side, because sometimes it gives really strange sensations, because you say, there is some things that you didn't realize from this perspective. So it may be a very interesting action to perform when you are in a critical moment of the game. So you can change it mentally and you can change it physically. Physically is what I just said. Just stand up and consider yourself as a spectator. You detach yourself from the being the player itself. You're not anymore the player. Of course, this is not done in a snap. You have to train, and we're going to explain that later on. But the principle is very simple. Alterate the reality. You're doing that all the time when you play chess. So you're going to use the proper scenarios and the proper training to reach this goal.
Yeah, indeed, it sounds very logical, and I would assume that the same techniques work even when we should face this typical difficult situation when we lose a game, because for every chess player, recovering from a lost game is one of the most difficult things. Many people can play well when the tournament is going their way, but when something unexpected and painful happens, for instance, lost game or undeserved draw, it seems that we start losing confidence, and we need the necessary tools to fight against this situation. Do you think that the dissociation can be a powerful tool in that regard as well?
it is. And most of the time in life, you are trying to use it without knowing it's a tool, and it's a very natural way. For instance, when you want to fight against pain, people have some pains due to post-operation or whatever thing. The very first thing to do when you have suffer heavy pain is to operate a dissociation. Yeah, because when you dissociate yourself, you're not leaving the pain at the first person, from the first person perspective. You are the third person perspective. Okay, so the chess player is exactly in the same situation. It has to find another perspective. The rest is only a matter of scenarios and specific capabilities, because everyone has not exactly the same, sensitiveness using visualization or, for instance, the use of hearing, smelling, touching, gust or sensation, skin sensation. So everybody is not having the same sensitivity. Yeah. And this is where you have to adapt a little bit. Okay. Some people feel pain in the stomach. Some of the sweats. Some have the heartbeats increasing. It's all a matter of different people and the way they react facing stress. So you have to adapt a little bit. But this is always alterating the reality. And this is the key, alterate the reality. You have to train how not to be yourself. But just taking out your chess techniques and abilities, and the rest is just training in the background, okay?
Okay, so when we speak about training, how not to be yourself, probably this is the time to discuss some simple protocols that all chess players and all people in general can apply in order to develop this skill.
Yes, Grigor, of course, you have first to understand that it's a tool.
Yeah.
It has a tool. The tool comes in handy in a perimeter, in a context, but the context has to be under control. And one day we will discuss also the context, because just a tool is good, but you have to know exactly when to use it. And what are the best way to use it and the best way not to use it properly. So you have, of course, one day to enter into this consideration. But let's put it very straightforward and simple. Suppose you're imagining that you are in another place. For instance, in a movie theater. Okay. And you watch the screen. Everybody has been to the movies. I think that there is no problem with that. And this highlights the fact that you have to bring back some souvenir of something that you already know, not something you create, but a situation you've been through it already. And the movies is one example. So you are the movies, you watch the screen, and a movie is going on, and you are in this movie. You are an actor, you know.
Okay.
And you see yourself playing chess in a tournament room. And you are sit in a chair within the theater and you watch this movie. So you're not associated. You are dissociated because you watch yourself. Okay. So if you are at the first rank, you're very close to the action, but you're not part of the action. You are dissociated. You are a spectator. Basically, you don't have the emotion of the one playing in the movie. You are the one watching the movie. It's different. If the emotion is too strong, very easy. You stand up and you go back two, three seats, two ranks behind. And you watch the one watching the movie at the first rank, and the first rank person is watching the movie on the screen. So you take some distances. You increase it. Okay.
Yep.
If on the other end you're very comfortable with the emotion, you can come back to the first rung, and you can also imagine you play the movie, you are in the movie, and then you have no problem to reassociate yourself. Okay. The funny thing about this example of scenario, it can be done even when you are at home on the bed, relaxing, and you perform this training of watching a movie where you are the first actor, you know, and you take the use of being capable to see yourself from a third person perspective, not in the first person perspective. This is very important to be capable to do that. And you do that by visualization. When you are in the movie theater, you smell, you hear all the little sounds, you feel the softness of the chair. You are completely out because you use all your senses to create the illusion of the change of reality. And the more it's accurate, the best it is. So when you are at the chessboard, you close your eyes for a short while, you can think everything you like. The movie theater is an example, but you could use, I don't know, a beautiful little house in the countryside with the river and the birds. You can be at the beach, having a good fruit juice or whatever you like. Everything is good for that. But what is important is that you have in the scenario the real yourself playing. You're not associating yourself, but you are at least having a view, a perspective of the real yourself. And this is where the thing becomes very interesting, because maybe you can have a real detachment of the emotion, and then you will not have any problems. When you will open your eyes, when you will reassociate yourself, you will have very much confidence in yourself, and you will be capable to evaluate properly the position without all these emotional, stress created by the context.
Yeah, so as far as I understand, this is the art of detaching images and emotions, and this ability will give you will provide you with a new perspective on how you see and evaluate the concrete situation.
Yeah, it is a real training that you can perform easily at home. For instance, let me give you some very simple example. If you are in the chair like this, you close your eyes, you can imagine, for instance, that you are in front of yourself because you know your face. You see it every day, I hope, at least. Okay. So, as you know very well your face, it's very easy when you close your eyes to see yourself. Okay. So, it's a very basic way to dissociate. It's the fact of imagining yourself in a third person perspective. Okay, this is the key. And you can also imagine the board in a different perspective. You are watching your chessboard, you close your eyes, there is a position. Okay, you can imagine being on the side of the chessboard or on the place of your opponent of the chessboard. For this, you have to print an image. You stand up. When you are at home, for instance, you put a position on the table, you stand up, you watch the chessboard from a perspective, you turn around 90 degrees and you go as a spectator, you watch the chessboard and you print this image in your head. But at the beginning, the image is not very accurate, but it's not important. It's just a matter of having a perspective, okay? No. Then you go at the opponent seat from over the shoulders and you can have a perspective from this point of view. Then you go back on your chair, you sit down, you close your eyes, and you keep these images you stored in your mind, and you recall them, okay? I don't know, you remember this Blumenfeld principle, very interesting, about the change of perspective. For instance, that Blumenfeld, if I recall this, he said that before playing the move, you have to watch the score sheet and write slowly the move. And then you go back to the chessboard and play the move and recheck it. Because Blumenfeld at that time was not capable to say the things properly, because he did lack probably some of these scientific aspects.
Yeah.
But he was right on the fact that you had to change your perspective. You have to make a separating state to cut the emotions. And this is the problem is exactly the same with the dissociation. You find a way to change your perspective and to cut the emotions.
Yeah, and actually, very often it happens that whenever you press the clock, you realize that the move that you have just played is a terrible mistake.
Yes.
Okay, as a joke, we can say that what Blumenfeld was doing is no longer permitted, because nowadays you don't have the right to write the move on the score sheet before playing it.
But you could imagine you do it.
Yeah, of course.
You can, for instance, closing your eyes, imagine you take your pen and write it, and we will come in for another tip I would like to give to our fellow friends, chess players.
Okay, please
remember, you have the power to do whatever you like in your mind. Chess regulations are only on the board. In your mind, you can do whatever you like. If you want to write down your move on the score sheets in your mind, it is absolutely possible. I used to say how to work your visualization skill, not to chess players, because chess players is very easy. Yeah? You materialize a chessboard in your mind and you start to play with the knight, go on squares, and you have tons of possibilities to train your visualization skills. But when people don't play chess, I used to say, write your name in your mind, okay? For instance, you close your eyes, you write Grigor. So you see Grigor. You see the letters. You see them. Play a game, change the first and the last and reverse them. And can you still see what it's written? You see, play with the letters and train your skills, because it obliges you to create a new visualization. You can do that with a chessboard piece, chessboard with pieces. You can do that with letters, with numbers. You can do that in so many ways. But the more you train to do that, the more you will be able to alter the reality, and the more it will have impact on emotions. Because if you can change what you see, you can change what you feel. And this comes to the point. If you feel cold, you can imagine you feel warm. If you feel wet, you can feel you are dry. If you feel anything, you smell, for instance, a flower, a rose, for instance, you can decide that you smell something else. For instance, I don't know, a good plate of spaghetti, a meal, whatever you like. So you can train to alterate every perception. And this is where the stronger you will be able to do that, the more you do that, and the more it will be easy to alterate the reality, like every chess player does when he plays. Okay?
Yeah.
So dissociation is stepping out yourself and everything by any means, any scenario you like, and be capable to return, of course, because you need to return to reality. Yeah, this is where also it's important, because you will have to move the piece on the chessboard and press the clock. Yeah. So the fact that you return to the reality, we must mention it, is where you become another time yourself, basically with all the resources you've been taking from the dissociation.
This sounds very interesting and powerful as a tool. So now, if you like, we can discuss one or two chess positions and see how the dissociation skill might have been applied. But I will mainly feature some mistakes. Okay, let me share the screen. Okay, let's first of all discuss one game between Magnus Carlsen and Nijat Abbasov, which was played a few days ago during the FIDE World Cup in Baku. Probably many players know this game. They have followed it. Nijat Abbasov, playing with black, had a wonderful chance of winning against Magnus himself, but he made a mistake which was unexplainable for the vast majority of chess experts. And now, together with Richard, we will try to find some possible explanations of this mistake. So, of course, I will not go very much into the detail concerning the technical part of the game, but let's just say that during the game, Carlsen with white pieces was pressing. He played the opening in a very creative way, creating a lot of practical problems for his opponent. Black was constantly under pressure during the game. I will fast forward until the critical moment, but on the board you can see the unorthodox concept applied by the world number one. He's no longer world champion, but due to the fact that he has the highest rating, we call it world number one. He was pressing all the time. Black was obliged to find some defensive resources. And at some point, they reached the following position. Let's fast forward a bit more. Yeah, so here in this position, when the biggest problems are already gone, Black is having a normal position already with enough resources to maintain the balance, Magnus Carlsen played the move queen to h2. Of course, escaping from the pin, putting pressure on the h6 pawn. But actually, this move is a decisive mistake that could have cost the game to Magnus. And what Black can do in this position? Okay, this is not a chess exercise. We are discussing psychology. I have no intention of overloading this video with technical details about how to play end games and dynamic chess as well. But actually, in this position, Richard, Black could have played the move. Let's even flip the board. Black could have played the move queen to f1. You see, this is a very active idea, penetrating White's camp and basically creating the decisive threat of rook g6 followed by rook g2. And actually, it's not clear how White can defend. It goes without saying that moving the bishop is pointless, because wherever the bishop goes, then the rook comes to e2 and the queen will be lost. And even the computer is already giving -6 or something. So White should just resign. And after listening to your explanations related to the dissociation, I can possibly try to explain what has happened in this game. Being constantly under pressure, Nijat Abbasov had difficulty to detach himself from the previous events in the game. And for him, it was very difficult to realize that in this position, active play is possible as well, and he has chances to win. I'm sure that if we give this position to Nijat Abbasov as a puzzle, in a heartbeat, he will notice the move queen f1, because by looking with fresh eyes, he will be looking for active possibilities. Nevertheless, after suffering tremendous pressure throughout the game. When coming to this position, it's very difficult to change our state of mind, and unconsciously we keep looking for defensive options that try to maintain the balance and to secure the draw. That's why actually he missed this active idea, Queen F1, in my opinion. What is your explanation?
This is the very old issue about the impact of the context in a chess game. Like you said, if it would be a puzzle, you would have solved it like this, because you see the critical construction here, as you taught me yourself times, okay? So you have a critical construction. But what I mean is that it would be interesting, for instance, to know what was the clock situation. It would be interesting to know probably that it did not take enough time to make a decision. As obtaining, for instance, a state of separation between previous move and next move. This is very important to use the experience to know when it's critical position, because there is moment where you have really to take the time because you know it's important. Every grandmaster, I remember Josip Dorfman wrote an entire book about when it's critical position.
Yes.
It is very important to be able at this moment to gather all the resources. Gather all the resources means I'm capable to break with the reality, to detach the emotion, get my resource, then reassociate and then play. Basically, you make a kind of reset, okay? It's a reset. You're not Abasov anymore. You are Mr. Freeze. You arrive at the table and you see this position, okay. I don't care I lose the match at the end. I don't care that this is Mr. Carlsen. It's just, you know, a computer playing. You don't take into consideration the background. You just don't care about the consequences of winning or losing. It has absolutely no importance. Okay, you're going to say, Mr. Buono, it's easy when you're in your chair to say that, but when you're playing for the final of a Chess World Cup, it's another thing. Yes, but the experience comes from the training. The more you trained on this aspect, the more you will be capable to do it in the top competition. It's a matter of training. This is a new skill that should be introduced from the very early ages of playing chess. And this, of course, is very often left behind because everybody wants to learn other aspects of the chess game. But we are human beings, and this is where it comes a difference. And I assume that in this position, there has been no state of separation between past and future. And he has been associated with the emotional workload. He may have forgotten also to watch some aspect of the position, like the critical construction, because this is something that comes for grandmasters, and you know what I'm talking about. You sometimes bypass the common rules because you feel so confident or so used to it that you don't take the time to return sometimes to the basics. And this is where grandmaster blunders happens most of the time. But in this situation, it could be a problem of not having take the time to detach the emotional aspect. Like you said, you play against the top player of the world. You are in a final of semi-final, it was, of the World Cup. This is a considerable pressure, you know, you have to handle. And this is where this kind of training becomes handy. Yeah.
Yeah, actually, I can recall what Vishy Anand tweeted regarding this game immediately after the finish. He said he wrote in Twitter that in chess, smelling the opportunity is one of the most difficult things. And after listening to your explanations, I can now say how much the ability to smell the opportunity is related to the art of dissociation.
I have a little detail I would like to, let's say, put forward. I had an excellent teacher one day that told me, in chess, first you have to look and then you proceed to your calculation and see.
Yeah.
This teacher, which I'm talking now, told me that, and it was very interesting because without knowing it, he said something very interesting that has a related to our discussion today. When you watch, you look without any consideration of calculation, you are putting your mind in a different state.
Yeah.
Okay. You watch the thing, you are a kind of spectator. You leave the things in a different state. You're not in exactly the same emotional state. You watch the board, you watch the pieces, you just look around, and you see what it triggers. Okay? If it triggers some intuition, but just you're like, not at the state of calculating.
You're scanning the position for possibilities.
Yes. And this is important because when you taught me this rule, Grigor, I remember during a long courses we had, and thank you so much. I mean, I remember this advice, but this advice was more deep than you probably expect at that time.
Sure.
It creates a different state of mind. It changes the pressure. When you're calculating, you are under pressure. You said, did I calculate well? Do you have to retry it? Many chess players have to face this issue. Eh? You calculate a variation, another, then you return to the first one. You are pretty sure that you didn't make any mistake, and you waste a lot of time doing that, and you increase the stress. Okay, so yeah. When you watch, you shut down this. You become a spectator. Many spectators watch. They're not all calculating what they see on the board. Huh?
Yeah, and by the way, I can share something from my practice as a chess trainer. Very often, I see that my students are prone to attach emotions to the moves that they're working. For instance, I'm looking at the position and I say, okay, what to play here? Rook g6 doesn't look good. This move seems interesting. This is a typical mistake because at the beginning, we should be looking for as many possibilities as possible. We just try to find many possible opportunities without attaching emotions to the moves. We just need to have a broader vision at the position. And then, when we have the full perspective, after making the dissociation, as Richard pointed out, then we can return to ourselves. We can finish this process of dissociation. And by using our intuition, we will decide which opportunities are worth considering, which opportunities can be discarded. And this is the pure technical part of the calculation process. But first, the first thing that we do is this general detachment. We're one computer that is just scanning the board for possibilities. In this way, we make sure that no good option will be missed. Nothing will escape our attention. And then we start relying on our common sense, intuition, and so on and so forth.
Yes, I would like to take a funny example of it. Suppose you make a combination and you just gain a pound. You are extra pound because the combination is the follow of a blunder made by your opponent. Your opponent may be angry, okay? But if you play against a computer, it will not be angry. It doesn't give a damn about the lost pawn because he's just playing, okay? You have to know how to become a computer. It's terrible to say that because I don't want to leave your own humanity behind, yes? But sometimes you have to be like a computer because when you are angry, you play in a way. When you are happy, you play in a way. Creativity needs calm, not agitation. People sometimes say, I play the Sicilian, I want to be aggressive player. And if they have, let's say, made a little mistake, they become angry and they start to play very aggressive. And this is not a positive way because the chess board is something materialized. You have to, let's say, watch the things in a way that is not influenced. There's no influence of your emotions. I have an image for that. If you want to see the bottom of, you see when you are at the beach and you watch the surface of the water and you don't see the bottom. If the water is very boiling, is very agitated, you have to have a water calm. Okay. And this is the same with the emotions on the chessboard. You have to keep it calm because when it's calm, you see everything. When it's agitated, you don't. And you have to reach this state where it's calm. You have to become a computer or, let's say, a statue, huh? A good statue. Yeah, you're a statue. You don't have emotions. You lost a pawn. You lost a piece. Okay, the game is not over. There's thousands of possibilities. Yeah. Maybe you end up in a draw or whatever. I don't know. There is so many things to consider about it. And this game is an example. What has been in the mind of the Abbasov at this moment, it's very difficult to know. But we can suppose that there has been some chain reaction due to the context. And
of course. So here, we are not generalizing the mistake that Abbasov has made. This is a pretty normal mistake. We just provide one possible explanation of what could have happened in his mind. But this is just one of the possible explanations, which, by the way, suits our topic very well. And for the final, I just want to make one remark. I know that this interview is already taking too much of a time, but speaking with Richard is always very interesting, and I grabbed the opportunity. Just something in relation to what you have just mentioned. In general, people are creatures that like to be consecutive. For instance, when you are playing a chess game, you keep playing well and you keep finding good moves only if you know that so far you have been doing everything right. And this is not only in chess, but also in life. We don't think with calculations, but human beings, they think in stories. And in order to act properly, humans need to have a proper story in their minds. That's why in the game of chess, when you have been playing very well until this point, you are likely to find the right continuation now. But if some bad things have happened until now and you didn't play in the way you wanted to play, then this sense of consecutivity is lost, and you are prone of making mistakes. This is not valid for computers that think in an algorithmic way, but for humans, this is a very typical mistake, and only this art of dissociation can help us improve in that regard.
Yeah, because it's a reset. It's a reset. It's a way to reset. You said something very interesting, because it leads to the concept that we may develop in another video, which is that you lose your self-confidence due to the little small failures. You know, small failures add themselves and create a state of lack of confidence. And you are creating a state of hypnosis with a very bad suggestions. Today I'm not feeling good. So you create an assessment, a truth that you accept for yourself. Today I don't see anything on the board. Today I don't feel very well, and such and such. So you feed your mind with these negative things, and your mind accepts them. You like it, because it's a way to legitimate your actions. Okay. And this is terrible, a terrible mechanic. One day we may develop this issue. But what you say is that you are in a state of, let's say, self-feeding of negative truths. And your inconscient is going to accept them, and it's going to ruin your play because you are under these new rules that you set, and it created disaster on the board.
Yeah, doctor, you have just said this indeed extremely important. I can share from my experience very often. I didn't even make a mistake during the game. This is not a mistake, but I realized that one calculation that I have made was not precise, that I missed something in my calculation. During the game, this little calculation inaccuracy didn't have any influence, because the opponent played something else. He didn't make use of my mistake. But already, as you have just pointed out, I start losing confidence, and this will unfortunately impact the further course of the game. This is very important, and even I take note to improve in that regard. So yes. Thank you very much, Richard, for this interesting conversation. It was very insightful for me, and I hope for all chess friends that are watching us. Of course, we will keep making such episodes. This will be a long-term series on chess psychology. And I hope that our contribution will be very useful for everyone. So thank you once again. And very soon we will talk again.
Thank you very much also, Grigor, for this invitation. I'm very glad to share all these things with everyone. And I'm sure that we will have very, very interesting conversation on this very nice topic.
That's for sure.